Hey everybody, and welcome to the Rabbit Trail Podcast. This is episode number 103.
103.
Wow.
See, you know,
I think you repeated me right there.
I feel like, you know, people are divided whether they want the long version 103 or the short version 103. And so I thought that if I echoed it differently, we could appease everybody.
No, you won't appease the math people because it's 103.
Oh.
No and.
Oh, now
no
we just and. Hit all three of them. So yeah. We're great.
Oh,
we're good.
Now.
And hey, if you're a math person.
Now
welcome.
We have just ventured into a whole new intro.
And I'm not a math guy.
Awesome. Well, we're just glad you're joining us. If you're not a math guy either, this is your perfect place because we're not talking about math. But sometimes.
And we're just perfectly imperfect.
We are, yes. We're just glad you're joining with us. Hey, this is a podcast where we're trying to chase the truth wherever it runs. What we mean by that is that we do a sermon here at the church that sponsors the podcast called Olive Branch Community Church. And by the way, my name is Greg Harris. I'm the pastor here at Olive Branch and glad you're joining us. And my co-hosts, Stephen and Brent, are here every week, even when I'm not. And
yay, Brent. Yay, Brent.
And so we're just picking up things that we may not have talked about or things that surfaced in the sermons and trying to follow down those paths for like clarity and maybe even to help complicate some things because, you know, one of the beautiful things about truth is it's never as simple as people think it is. And I love that. Like it opens new doors and new things to see. And that's when you really know you've hit something well. But that's what we're hoping to do. And so, guys, say hi. I pass it on to you.
Hello. Yeah,
good. Thanks, Brent.
There you go. No. Hey, thank you for watching, guys. My name is Stephen Oldham, local outreach coordinator here at Olive Branch. But I just wanted to say thank you for you guys who are responding. Some of our responses online have become noticeable. People are kind of talking to us more locally. I know a lot of you, I see us at church, and I just had a great conversation with someone on Sunday who's listening to the podcast, and he's like, I'm hearing your voice talk about history. I'm like, oh, I hope this is good. Because you were talking, and he's like,
I'm a history teacher.
So. He's like leaning back, and he's like, I'm remembering the podcast now. I'm like, oh, so that's the reason why we do this. I think it's fun to talk with people. It gives them a conversation on your drive home. So, if you're listening, subscribe wherever you're at on whatever you're watching or listening to, or if you're watching us on YouTube, hit the bell, hit subscribe, like, stars, all those things are good.
And share it, you know,
yeah,
let friends know if you find this helpful or interesting, and we would love to answer their questions, right, Brent?
That's right. And you can send your questions or your comments in to us by emailing rabbittrail@obcc.church. rabbittrail@obcc.church.
I can't repeat that any differently, yeah. So it's going to be the same.
rabbittrail@obcc.church. 102.
Or NPR now.
Yeah. So we would love to hear your comments. We would love to hear your feedback. We would love to hear your suggestions. We would love to hear you take a guess as who's going to wear the Rabbit Trail Podcast t-shirt next week.
Nobody.
Greg just brought that up right before we got on air, and he was just talking about, you know, wow, we should do a roulette thing because it just seems like one of us seems to always have the shirt on during the podcast, but rarely do all of us or more than one of us have it on. So
one of these things
it's really a laundry issue.
It is. We all have a different laundry schedule, apparently.
So, you know, and for me, I was just talking to somebody about this with laundry. Like, Friday's my day off, and that's when I do my laundry, right? So I take my laundry, and I take it all in from the hamper. I dump the whole thing into the washing machine. I do my laundry, throw it in the dryer, fold it up, and put it away. And then the next workday or whatever, I grab a shirt, I put it on with no foreknowledge or planning of my wardrobe, and I often think, did I just wear this the last day? Yesterday when I worked. So I always feel like people must think I don't do my laundry. So if you see me in the same shirt frequently, it just means that was on the top of my pile when I did my laundry.
Yeah, it's so funny. Like it's so nice that you can get to do that. Like I'm in a different space in life, right? So it's like I go, you know, I get to my weekend. I'm ready to do my laundry. I grab my laundry basket finally, and it's like full and overloaded, and it's just ridiculous. So I bring it in. I'm like, yes, I'm going to get it done. And who the heck's in doing their laundry? Like my kids are so good. They do their laundry, their own laundry. They wash it. They, you know, they dry it. They fold it. And so they're inevitably always one of them in front of me. Somebody always gets there 10 minutes. And I'm like, I got to wait a half hour and I'm never going to remember. It ends up being next day. Like I get to it and somebody beats me again. I just, it's just a torturous existence.
Yes. With six people in your house, that could be a problem.
Yeah.
So I do get that.
And then sometimes when my in-laws are down, it's eight people. And then there's just no way I'm getting, if I look like I'm wearing the same clothes 2 days in a row, it's because I'm wearing the same clothes 2 days in a row.
Yeah. And I mean, I do my laundry. My wife won't let me touch her laundry because she sees how I do my laundry. And she
cares about her wardrobe.
Again, right. She doesn't want everything one color. But again, it's, you know, and I just want to, you know, I'm sure the women, you know, listening right now are just thinking, oh my gosh, these men are amazing. They do their own laundry. So guys, step it up. Do laundry at home.
I live alone. If I don't do the laundry, it stays where I left it.
There is times where it's like, okay, I need to do my laundry today. And then I look and there's laundry in the dryer that needs to be folded. And I'm like, yeah, I'll wait. You know, I'll wait. I'll do my laundry later after that gets folded. So my wife washes and folds her laundry. I wash and I fold my laundry. And then oftentimes I come to bed at, you know, 11 o'clock, dead tired, ready to go to sleep. And my wife has taken all of the towels and thrown them on my side of the bed. So I got to fold the towels and put them away before I go to bed.
Oh, that's like a honey-do list in real time. Like, yes. Did you know the funniest thing, since we're on laundry and this is just a ridiculous segue?
How did we get here?
Rabbit trail talk. Shirts.
Welcome to Laundry Talk, podcast about laundry.
Dude, we're airing out our dirty laundry, dude.
I'm serious that I have an incompetence. I have this like deep shame about folding my laundry now because my mother-in-law is amazing at this. Like she, like
the origami of laundry folders.
Seriously, like she's like, I come home, she fold my laundry. I'm like, I thought my Tress, how did my laundry get so like? She's like, I didn't do it. That's my mom. I'm like, I mean, it is like paper, like. Wow. The military would love her, like that kind of level.
Does she have like one of those folding boards?
No, she just took home ec, and she took home ec in high school, and just found out she had a knack for it, and just amazing at it, just amazing at it. Anyway, so I feel really embarrassed if I was ever to fold anything at her house. That's just like, ugh.
Yes, I will say though, it does not bother me when I'm dead tired. I walk up to bed thinking I'm crawling in bed and going to sleep, and there's a big stack of towels to be folded and put away. That doesn't bother me. What kills me is when it's 11 o'clock and I go to bed and my wife's still downstairs and she washed the sheets and didn't put sheets on yet, you know? And then you're looking at that going, I gotta do the sheets before I can crawl into bed. And
again, I can just sleep with any blanket I want to.
I know.
No one's gonna get mad.
I would think that if I was single, I would never wash my sheets.
Oh, okay. Well, I would. But I do like to just use the same blankets over
Brent,
and over.
You have this odor about you. I just can't place.
I'm telling you, if I was a bachelor, it would be pathetic. I am neat. You know, I don't like messes, so my dishes are always
Brent,
done.
Is that cradle crap?
Yeah, exactly. You know, I go, whew. You know, I need to take a shower. It's been 4 days.
All right, we need to move on, man. Let's get way too
Speaking
close to
showers.
Other conversations.
All right. Let's move on. All right. So number one, we got some questions today, which is cool. I'm looking forward to getting to those. But again, we are in the sermon series, Offended. This one was overlooking offenses. You know, and so I one of the things you said that I thought was pretty clever, and I don't know if it was yours or if you picked it up from somebody else, but overlook the small, but forgive them all. So God has commanded us to forgive everybody for all things, but overlook the small offenses. You know, it's not a big deal. I think you made a comment about traffic or, you know, the stress and arguments in there. And it sparked my mind, right? So let me ask you this: if this is biblical and if this is wise to do, okay? So when it comes to forgiving the small, and you had mentioned the stress in traffic, and you know, you're gonna hit my wife in the passenger seat. Absolutely, is the worst. I mean, I don't know what
when
it is.
When has your wife ever been in the passenger seat with you?
No, I drive almost all the time now.
Really?
Yeah. And she used to always drive.
Yeah.
And really it came down to, I always have the cruddy car in our relationship, you know. Basically, she used to drive a lot more than me. So she always got the new car And then I would get her old car that had, you know, 200,000 miles on it and was broken down. So we always drove her car because it was the good car. Mm. So she always drove everywhere. But now I drive everywhere. And I'm telling you, driving somewhere with Nancy in the passenger seat is not necessarily a good thing if we want to arrive there in good spirits, because she is horrible. And I don't, and she knows this. I'm not saying anything she doesn't know.
I have no comment here.
Yeah. And she just, like, you know, gripes about everything. I'm in the wrong lane. Hey, you know, 2 miles up, somebody's hitting their brakes. And she's always like, you know, and so finally, I always get mad. And so you brought that up and I realized, okay, I need to do better job at forgiving her and letting those things and overlook those offenses, because they do work me up.
By the way, this is an incredible thought, because I've sat in the car with Brent driving, and you are like one of those like people who are so, I would have called you like extremely patient driver, because you don't care when you're going to get anywhere. Like I've sat with you and you've driven behind a big rig going 45 in the freeway while everybody else is going 70. And you're just like, yeah, well, we're behind the big rig right now. I'm just like, okay. Yeah.
So, and I will say, I like to just casually go. And one of the times you said, I don't care when I get there. No, I'm always early. So I'm not in a rush. I'm not stressed out, you know, to get somewhere. If I'm behind a car that's going the speed limit, which probably the trucks are, you just are an impatient driver, Greg. And so therefore, speed limits are not good enough. Go around this guy and break the law. That is the word that my pastor gives me. But I also know if I go into a clear lane, right, then I'm going to be going 90 miles an hour or 85 miles an hour. So I'd rather sit behind somebody that governs me from a speed standpoint. Mm. And Nancy is uncomfortable with that too. But, you know, so here's the thing. I was looking at going, okay, I need to forgive her. I need to be more holy in that area. And so then I thought to myself too, and just, is this a good practice, right? So when she starts doing that, and I know I need to forgive her and I need to overlook this, if I was to just pull over the car and kick her out and make her walk home, right? So that I can, on the way home by myself, work through that forgiveness and overlooking. And then when she gets home, right, we could kind of see who's more holy. Mm. You know, who forgave who faster, you know? And it would be a good way for each of us to measure our spiritual life. What do you think of that?
You know, Brent, I'm going to challenge you to really try that this week and come back next week and tell us how that goes.
Yeah. I would say sometimes going to your pastor for advice is probably not the best thing to do.
Just step out in faith.
Yes. Yes. All right. I'm sorry. So, but I do like that. I do like that idea. Overlooking the small things. And we say that in my premarital counseling. You can't fight about everything. You know,
yeah, don't make
fight about the things that are critical, right? You know, but again,
don't die on every hill, right? These all these different comments we say to ourselves, which I don't think people believe anymore,
right? But so, what does that look like to overlook, but not just be a doormat, right? For minor offenses.
Well, I mean, I'll be honest. This is the Tim Keller's book, mm-hmm. Forgive. It's the last book he wrote.
Yeah,
and it is really, really good. And for the reason that he dealt with something almost prescient, because he started writing it before COVID.
Prescient? What does that mean to us normal people?
So like almost like he could see the future. Oh, wow. So like he was seeing things out there. And what was fascinating is because he was dealing with New Yorkers, right? And so they felt like the idea of forgiveness was wrong.
Get out of here.
No, like even more so, like you were being a doormat. You were allowing people to get away with evil. If you didn't address it, you were adding to injustice and inequality in the world, and not by not addressing every evil every single time. And that just is like, whew, that would be heavy and hard. So
exhausting.
And so what does it look like to overlook an offense? You know, what is that?
Without being a doormat, what do you picture that looking like?
Well, again, I think that's understanding when we talked about those fears of kind of that picture of the big circle on the outside, where there are some things that just don't offend you. They're not going to be offensive. You can say, you know, and say certain things and not going to bug you. then there's those things that kind of get under your skin a little bit, like a disagreement or something like that. I just think in those cases, you're allowed to engage, but is it causing you to want to not be around the person? Like, that's a little too serious. It's a little too close to comfort. Even in the case where I have major disagreements theologically with people, doesn't mean I don't want to be around them or hang out with them. Like, I have Mormon friends. I have people who are Catholics. I have people who are, you know, Reformed or Arminian or whatever. And I met lots of people who don't want to hang out with people who don't agree exactly with their particular theology. And that's just weird to me. That's like taking the wrong thing too close to the middle. And so there's that aspect that I think that you got to know what should activate you to action and truly be offended. Otherwise, it's as easy as just kind of going like, I may have meant it poorly, or he may not have meant that at all. I mean, I've done things like that. It's really trying to put yourself in a human perspective that we all do these kinds of things to each other. I don't know, Stephen, you want to throw in on that, or Brent, you?
Well, I think it depends on the kind of, like, I always go back to the passage where it says, if someone slaps you in the face, you know, turn the other cheek. It's not quite the same as a stab in the chest, right? So there is some kind of spiritual triage going on here by analyzing what is the offense, right? And so to me, a slap in the face, it's insulting, it's painful, like you mentioned your message on the list of things. But it's not something you can't endure. If your strength comes from needing other people to validate you, every kind of offense you have to answer, because you have no core, you have nothing that's telling you who you are. But as Christians, we have Christ as to who we are, so we can take a lot of insults because we know where we stand with him. I think it just hurts depending on who the person who does it to you. Usually they hurt more, offenses hurt more from someone you care about because they seem to know more about you. They probably know your blind spots, and so it hurts a little bit when it stings. And so the question is, how do you take that? But again, I think it has to do with that being mercy is kind of the extension for minor infractions that helps life get by. You imagine if everyone had to stop working to address every minor offense. Hey, you bumped into me. Hey, no work would get done. Nobody would care about each other. No one would be able to, because we're humans, we have to notice that we have to let some things go, and we can't make everything the main thing that's core to our foundation, or we're just gonna spend all day being the God of justice, going around trying to solve all the world's problems, and that can be exhausting. Also, you're not going to be able to see all the other things God wants you to do throughout the course of the day. And if it's not a major offense, it'll also interfere with the relationship. The ability to overlook a minor offense is a good way to love someone, but the question is, how do you know the difference between a minor and a major offense? I think that's the harder part. Like, if someone's like, "Hey, I hate you," and you're like, don't know them, and you're driving by and going, "Oh, okay." I don't need to flip them off. Why? I don't. What does that have anything to do with me? In 3 seconds, that person's out of my life. I'm just drive by.
Most comments.
I don't care.
Yeah, I really feel like most comments and stuff on the internet are far more like somebody seeing a snapshot of you in your car and yelling at you about what you're doing from the side of the road.
Yeah.
Your life keeps driving on, and they somehow made a judgment, get to yell at you, and you're going to spend all day pulling the car over to kick your wife out and make her walk home. No, I pull out, you know, and talk to them. Nah, there's a serious sense that to overlook an offense in my mind is, again, knowing what the difference between the big and the small is. And even in certain cases where they may be big, still choosing to overlook it, but it's a choice. It has to be a choice. It's not something that I'm not saying you're not going to feel offended. I'm not saying you're not going to feel those ways.
It's going to hurt.
Yeah. And our modern, he does a great job of making us remember that our modern psychology is about giving you this personal autonomy and agency. And so it is about you returning to your choices and your things. And so forgiveness even gets twisted in on this one as about you feeling good about you and feeling good about how you feel. And so if you're going to overlook an offense, it's about, you know, your empowerment and stuff like that. And really, this is simply about virtue. It is a virtue to be the kind of person who is so established in God that, you know, really the insults and the offenses, they may sting, but when you overlook them, you realize it just returns you back to, you know, I stand in somebody other. I stand in God. I don't know how. And I'm sure there's somebody out there who's tried to think of a way, but I don't know how you ground a self-confidence without God. You know, I don't. In fact, the confidence, the word is actually a derivative of confide, with faith. Mm-hmm. Like, you were literally, you have confidence. You stand with faith in God. And so I can be confident. I can stand with trust in the one that I am trusting and be confident in that truth, confident in that person. The only reason I feel any kind of confidence is not because I think I'm got all that down. And, you know, no, it's because God made me to be who I am. He's put me at this time, and I trust him that he's got a purpose for me here. And that, you know, that doesn't mean I'm not going to learn or grow from what somebody tells me, because that's the other thing. When you overlook an offense, sometimes that opens you up to learning from your enemy as your accuser. You're willing to back up and go, oh, wait, maybe they were right. Maybe that was a stupid statement. Maybe that was a harmful or hurtful or whatever thing. But I do think that you can't get there. If everything's an offense and everything's a defense of your own self, there's no corrective. Who can correct you? Who could ever tell you that you're wrong?
Let me ask you this. Okay, and I can't think of it offhand, but the target that you drew and yeah. you've been using throughout the series, and the center
is God.
Is God, and then there's anger and, you know.
Well, I'm using like energy levels. Like you've got yeah. irritation, anger, and outrage.
So the lightest ones are irritations, right?
Yeah.
So would you think that in that realm, that light realm of irritation, somebody irritating me and I overlook it, do you think that is forgiveness or is it just overlooking it, you know?
Yeah, I think that that's a type of forgiveness. I think some things are harder to forgive than other things. I think forgiveness is the ability to let go the right for punishment. Right. I mean, in essence, it's the absorbing of the penalty and the releasing of judgment. And so, yeah, when you overlook something, it's just a really, sometimes there's really easy things to overlook. In fact, that whole outer space of disagreement, that I think that what happens is that the irritation starts to move into insults. And so that there's like levels of certain kinds of slander. There's no disagreement that would get you angry anymore mm-hmm. or get you irritated. You're just like, well, yeah, we're disagreeing, and this is a good conversation. And I think that's where you can get as a Christian, if you really are confident in God. And then when people are slandering you, yeah, I think sometimes a slander can be irritating. Sometimes it's painful and hurtful in the sense of like somebody insulting you or whatever. So then that gradation moves more into that center because that is starting to hit more of the personal kind of space. So I don't know.
And yeah. I think with that kind of forgiveness, you know, I mean, there, you know, the deeper forgiveness where someone has truly wronged you, you know, and harmed you, you know, I mean, you know, that there's an aspect of that, that, you know, that's God working through you and able to, for you to forgive,
yeah, yeah.
right? The lighter forms of forgiveness, like just somebody's irritating you or they have a different opinion.
Or they cut you off in traffic.
Yeah.
Or,
you know, and I think sometimes, you know, we are just offended if somebody, because we don't give people the freedom to think differently than us, right? But one of the things,
you mean like you've freedom to think differently than us, like what do you mean by that?
Like I hold an opinion and you hold another opinion, and no, you need to think like me, you know, otherwise I'm really angry, you know. Especially, you know, you see it in politics, especially, you know, we think differently about political issues, and it's just like there's no calming you down. Why can't you just give them the freedom to think differently, you know? And I'm not talking about, you know, biblical issues in politics. I'm talking about political views, you know, and how those
differentiate that. I think that's important. Like,
yeah. I mean, if you're talking about abortion, then, you know, I think there's only one way to think about that as a Christian, you know? But if you're talking about, you know, social issues and, you know,
like how to handle
homelessness. And okay, both sides should agree we need to help people who need help, but how we help people, or, you know, that could be a differing opinion of how much help should you give and how do you help somebody.
Well, I mean, what do you do when somebody holds the opinion that the homeless should be allowed to do what they're doing because it's their freedom to live that way? This is like a legitimate lifestyle that they want to live. And so let's help them even live it well. And let's give government help to them. Like,
and that's part of what I'm talking about too, right? If you held that opinion, which I know you don't, but if you held that opinion, okay, I'm not going to fight with you, you know? I mean, probably I'm not changing your mind anyway, you know? But I guarantee you, when that hits your neighborhood, you're going to think more like me, you know? But again, I want to give you the freedom and not take it personally that you think differently than me. H. Norman Wright, in one of his premarital books, had a statement about committing to one another in a marriage. And he's talking, you know, and this works in other relationships, not just marriage. But, you know, he said that, you know, in marriage or in a relationship, you are making an unconditional commitment, really, to an imperfect person, you know. And we hear that and we go, well, psh, duh, you know, okay, yeah, I understand that, right? But then when you get married with them and live with them, you're irritated that they're not perfect, you know? It's like, I know you're not perfect, but emotionally, I have a problem with you not being perfect, you know? And so again,
because it's inconvenient on my for right. me, or it's a, you know, it's causing problems, or there's other, yeah, there's all kinds of things that go around on those.
And so part of that lighter end of forgiveness is just understanding that, okay, why am I holding you to a standard of perfection when I know you're not perfect, you know? And I can let go of some of that stress and tension in a relationship, whether it be marriage or otherwise.
Yeah. Part of the problem is just people's view of self-esteem and where we get it from has changed over the years. The culture, you talked about psychology a while back, and really I don't think it's all of psychology. It's secular humanist psychology, which is talking about what's called person-centered theory. And this is where everybody has gone. Where, as a Christian, you know, if I just say, you know, we're going to start with psychology being about the person-centered, already the thing is completely off, because the only thing that allows me not to take an infraction, if it's this, I'm the center of the universe, there isn't anything that would allow me to take an infraction like that, because it is an offense to me. And if I'm the supreme authority about what's offensive, there's no way I'm going to let that go, right? Unless I get a benefit out of it. So now we're talking about, does this benefit me or not? And so all relationships become about how I get benefit or what's good for me. In a God-centered world where God is the center of your psychology, the idea is that he is the final authority. And so now I can let things go because there's another person that will have a say in the end. And so I'm able to tolerate more and have more mercy because I'm not the center of the universe. God is. And so now I can start to go, well, I can let big things and little things go if I know someone's going to amend my heart, take care of my soul, help me navigate the relationship, because now we have a baseline for how you treat each other that isn't based on me and you. Now we're going to fight, but based on an arbitrary source that we all need, that we can all regulate our behavior off of. The less objective thing you have outside of a couple, the more, I think, the poorer the relationship's going to be, because there is no arbiter of that other than what you both can get a benefit. If I can convince you both in a counseling session that, hey, this will benefit you and that will benefit you, well, the marriage will last a couple more years until it stops benefiting people, because you're the arbiter of what you want and what you get. That feels so empty when you're in a relationship, because, you know, I think deep down inside that's not fulfilling, that I'm not doing the right thing because I'm not a good measure of what's right and wrong. And I think that's instinctual, and that's why people get divorced so fast. Why, oh, it was great, well, it lasted, and wow.
Yeah, and love becomes a self-centered, self-actualization situation, and I, you know, oh, I just feel so differently about this now. And it's like, that's not how, that's how love becomes so, like, we used to call it in seminary, like marshmallow love. Like, you just throw it, and it's like,
And that's why, too, I think, you know, I've been married 40 years, and I think one of the reasons that our marriage has been so successful is Nancy realizes what a benefit it is to her to be married to me, you know.
And that's why we keep you here.
Yeah.
Because she found out what a benefit it was.
Yeah.
The interesting thing for me is that, Stephen, you brought this up a while ago, and it was a picture I wanted to bring in, but I didn't. But when you can overlook an offense when, you know, when you're a kid and somebody insults you and your dad's standing next, I mean, like.
Yeah, it's like when someone punches your brother punches you in the shoulder, or your sister punches you in the shoulder, you're like, ooh, because dad's standing over there and they don't see it. And they're like, ha, ha, ha. You're like, I'm just going to watch this one here. I'm not going to get in trouble by punching you back, because there's someone's going to take care of this problem. The ability to take the punch is directly related to the person you think is going to bring justice. And if you don't have that person, then you do have to punch back because there's no one else around.
But it also, I mean, you think about that. It's also the reason why there are refs and umpires in the sports games we have. Imagine if we played sports or had a boxing or an MMA
and there were
event.
No rules.
And it was all about how that person felt the rules should go. Like, we're trying to do with all other forms of relationship right now. where it's just like, oh, it's all about what I think is right. I mean, though, people would be dying in the middle of these events. Every sports team, every sports thing would end
up. Are you not entertained?
Right. It would turn into the NFL. It would turn into the NHL. Everything would turn into a fist fight, like basketball fist fight, football fist fight, like because everybody start fighting over the what the rules are. And
that's why there's a penalty box. I mean, we do this in life. I actually think people know instinctually, at least in the way their behavior is, that there is. It's better to live under an objective standard that's better than me, because you typically tend to seek a counsel of something outside yourself. You want the approval of others. You want the cops to validate you. You want the law. You want the courts. And you want an outside source to validate your opinion.
And that is why politics has taken the place that it has. When we go back to this conversation, why people get so upset about politics is because they're arguing right now. We're arguing for who's going to beat God and when the government picks a position, that gets to be God. In fact, there was years ago, we were laughing because you'd go across the street and there was this little thing that says, don't steal or something like that. It's against the law and it's bad too, or something like that. It was like, wait, that should be inverted. Like it's evil to steal and it's against the law. You know, the moral consequence to your soul should be greater, but because we don't have an outside of our universe grounding for what is right and what is wrong, we only have an inside, and now we're all fighting over who gets to control the quote God, the
arbiter of other people's behavior that gets in the way of my self-actualization.
Right. And thus we have HOAs.
And you were talking about, you know, just that's why it's so important in relationships too, to have an objective truth and not a subjective
truth.
That's
why people go to a counselor, hopefully.
They want
an outside opinion.
I think
the
other thing
too
is objective truth doesn't really change. You know, subjective
truth. By definition, it shouldn't.
It shouldn't change.
Subjective truth doesn't change either, but. Just so you know, in reality, a subjective truth doesn't change. All a subjective truth in technical terms is the difference between an opinion, where Brent, your opinion would be mint and chip ice cream is the best. Mm. I don't know, right? What's your opinion? What's your favorite?
Unless you lie to yourself.
My favorite ice cream is probably Thrifty's Rocky Road.
Okay, so
that's
you could
true,
so
right?
The truth is Brent's probable favorite ice cream is Thrifty's Rocky Road. That is a subjective truth. It means it's a truth that's
I
not
can't validate it outside of
objective
you,
for it, every human yeah. being, but it is subjectively true for you.
Right.
And so that's a subjective
truth. My flavors change, you know?
But that's okay, because then the truth would be, well, that's no longer mine. It was, but now it isn't. And so that would still be true. It's just that you changed your flavor.
Time changed but in that moment at that time, that is the subjective truth.
That's the problem with art right now, is the fact that there are subjective things that people do that can be subject. That's why people go to court to see if that had value or was still true. And art is one of those things where people say, oh, it's subjective. That means I can say whatever I want. I'm like, not really. There's a lot more truth, even if I make a statement.
Yeah, we mix up subjectivity with licentiousness with what was the term? Relativity. Relativity and subjectivity are not the same. Now, if you want to claim that there's relative truth, then I think that's kind of what you meant.
Well, there's also objective truths that are true for everyone, right? And so that's different than my own opinion.
And we may sound like really silly about this.
It's important.
But it's super important because, I mean, in this case, we're talking about how to think clearly. And when we don't have these categories, people, we don't think clearly. We get confused. We start yelling and screaming because we do feel more offended about things because we don't even know what category we're talking about sometimes. Are you insulting me? Are you insulting my idea? Are you insulting, and that whole target doesn't make sense if we don't understand, like, there are categories of ways of thinking. So,
well, just like when someone comes along and they say, I feel a certain way, we're now all mostly in the category of what they're expressing. And if they don't know what they're expressing, this is why when you don't know something about, say, you don't know why you're offended, you should analyze it because you have more facts as to why that's probably happening. And you need to seek outside help to kind of see which of those are true and not. So you clarify your thoughts more clear. The thing as a Christian is I don't do that by myself. I have a standard to go, I'm feeling this way, is it appropriate? So the problem is most people say, I feel a certain way, so therefore that's true and everyone should accommodate that truth. And the Christian goes, I feel this way, but is that right? Is that good? I need
to know. Does that fit with the truth?
Does that fit with God's plan? Should I feel this thing? Is it a good thing? Most people are just like, I'm living out of my reality. I don't need to ever question anything. And that's why everybody's fighting all the time, because our realities are, quote unquote, running into each other. And then we don't have an outside source. And this is why I say it's important to measure even your feelings, not based on that, but based on scripture, based on the cumulative wisdom and word of God, the things that come out of it, because you can really deceive yourself quite a bit.
Yeah. So, and I mean, again, you know, and also when you're looking through scripture, sincerely, a lot of times, you know, the scriptures tell you how you should respond emotionally and otherwise towards situations and offenses. And we need to remind ourselves what is proper and what is not proper. But again, going back to that, overlook the small, but forgive them all. You brought it back up at the second half of your sermon. And the proverbial question of, well, how often do I need to forgive them, you know? And you were talking about, you know, the Pharisees were like, three times. That's, you know, hey, you know, that's a good number, three times. And then Peter's like, I say seven times. That's even better. And, you know, God said 70 times seven times, you know, seven times 70 times. And you were saying that means fully, completely forgive them every time, you know, it occurs. So again, when you were saying that, I'm sitting in the seat and I'm thinking of the many counseling sessions that I've had with married couples, you know, and there's been these offenses in the marriage, like, you know, serial adulteries or, you know, drug abuse, relapses of addiction and, you know, those cycles going on and on. So as you're saying that, I'm thinking of couples like that, hearing that going, okay, you know, I guess I just need to forgive him again and just continue moving on. So, again, if we're to forgive every single time it occurs, then how do you really enforce consequences in those situations if I'm forgiving you every single time?
I think the answer to that is that you're welding forgiveness and reconciliation together in the sense that somehow forgiveness is all it takes to resolve the problem. Forgiveness is not all it takes to resolve any
problem.
That's
the starting point.
It's the starting point. And it's the starting point for you. Henry Cloud and Townsend, they always say that forgiveness takes one, but reconciliation takes two. Mm. And we'll really hit some of the beginnings of reconciliation. Like, that's the whole next 2 weeks is the process that we should follow in that pattern. And it's not
so that's easy. A plug right there, people. Yeah. Listen.
It's not an easy process. But I do think it's good to note that there is a tendency that we think that that they should somehow overlook offenses like that. There is a point at which when the sin is continual, Galatians actually says, when you find someone who's stuck in sin, go to them and help them basically get out of it, but be careful because you might get pulled in yourself. Don't be tempted. And this is the case that's a consequential kind of conversation. If you've sinned and you are not, and you're just saying sorry, a question I first want to ask is a lot of times it's like, well, are you sorry because you got caught or are you sorry because it's wrong? And, you know, I got kids. They're really good at apologizing when they got caught. But it's one thing when they come to me and they acknowledge what they've done. They bring it out. And then they start working on restitution, like what they're going to do to make it right because they did this thing. That's different. And then now we're talking about like a journey of recovery or something like that, where you should see progress and development and serious work done. And I think that unfortunately a lot of people are too easy because they've taken forgiveness and they think, well, I forgave, I got to give trust. And like, I mean, Tim Keller's book, every book I've ever read on forgiveness makes it absolutely clear. Just because you've forgiven does not mean you return to the same level of trust.
Trust is both given and earned.
Right. We're not, when we were forgiven by God, he didn't just whisk us right into Eden. Like right back to where we have absolute perfect access to him. And I don't, you know, in some ways we're developing, we're growing. He's helping us. Now he's more like a coach than a cop. Like he's coming in to help us stand up. And even when we're sinning against him, he's just incredibly gracious like that. But that's implying that we're still desiring and fighting forward and not just complacent with our sin. At that point, he says there's just no forgiveness for those kinds of people.
Okay, so you and I understand this. So a lot of these questions I'm kind of asking just to strike conversation and ask questions that people might have. But so
oh good, because I was really worried about you and Nancy. Here
yeah, yeah. I haven't kicked her out of the car yet. You know that the idea of forgiveness and reconciliation are different. But again, part of the forgiveness thing, and you know, I mean, we're commanded, God forgives you as you forgive others. Like in the same way you forgive others is the same way that God is going to forgive you. If you're unwilling to forgive, he's going to be unwilling to forgive you. And so part of that forgiveness that we give people and give ourselves is part of that image of Christ or image of God, you know, demonstrating that characteristic in him. So then you can think, okay, well, there's been sins in my life, right, that I've just committed over and over and over and asked for forgiveness and, you know, and then fall back into it and then ask for forgiveness. And God has never said, okay, that's it, I'm done, I divorce you, you know. So, you know, he always, you know, I feel like, you know, I've always had a relationship with God. And so again, when somebody is having those issues in their marriages, shouldn't we represent God by forgiving them every time and maintaining a relationship? It's kind of a rhetorical question, but it's one to strike conversation.
Oh, go ahead.
Okay, so again, I think that you're still conflating the concepts together, where somehow because I've forgiven doesn't mean there's consequences. And that's critically clear when you go consider... I mean, here's Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 12 says, consider him who endured from sinners such hostility against himself, so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding blood. And have you forgotten the exhortation that addresses you as sons? My son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor be weary when reproved by him. For the Lord disciplines the one he loves and chastises every son whom he receives. It is for discipline that you have to endure. God is treating you as sons. For what son is there whom his father does not discipline? If you are left without discipline in which all have participated, then you are illegitimate children, not sons. Besides this, we've had earthly fathers who disciplined us and we respected them. Shall we not much more be subject to the Father of spirits and live? For they disciplined us for a short time as it seemed best to them, but he disciplines us for our good, that we may share in his holiness. And yeah, for the moment, all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant, but later it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. And to me, what he's getting into here is very clearly like, if God's going to discipline, he loves you, he's forgiven you, but that doesn't mean there's not consequences. There's not things that are going to continue forward. Stephen, you jump in here.
Yeah, just people conflate a lot of things with forgiveness, even starting with the word confessions. Like people will confess. Confession is a part of repentance, but just saying the words doesn't make them magic. You don't get to just like, it's a magic eraser. Every time you do something to someone, if you say these words, then everything is fine. There has to be some actions that follow with that, some consequences. You have to be a contrite heart. It's like God forgave me. That's not a license to sin. And it's in that same model that we see how we would deal with someone else. If you continue to sin, then do you really want a relationship with God? Well, then why would we be any different? If someone continues to sin and say they're repentant, but they really, nothing is showing in their character or their heart, they're not being held accountable, they're not doing anything but repeating the infraction, then did they really ask you for forgiveness? Did they just use that as an excuse to keep harming you? And they need to know that that isn't appropriate how you treat somebody. And even God would be like, I'm going to give you over to this repetitive sin so that perhaps while you're out there, you'll learn. And the same thing sometimes happens with people in relationships. I can't have you continuously harming everyone and everyone. For your own good, this is what I need to leave you up to the consequences of your actions. But it's not something God does lightly. It's over a usually repetitive period of time. You see how long-suffering God is. But it does come, and it does come even on this side of the grave. There are times God says, okay, you want to keep doing that? Well, I'm going to send a friend. I'm going to send a church. I'm going to send a message. I'm going to send something that's stirring your heart. I'm going to send consequences. And the last is like, okay, you just don't want to listen, so I got to give you over to that thing so you know what slavery's like, because you forgot what it was like to be enslaved to things.
And he's good and gracious. Like, I'll just, as a personal...
Only
like,
to get you to come back.
As a personal expression of that. I mean, I've had situations in my life where there was a point in which due to my history and all this stuff, a particular sin kept coming up, and God literally, I really believe that he just said, look, you do it again, I'll show you how far this goes. And I was sort of like, I love you, but you're not going to keep doing this, and I'm going to show you the full blown outright consequences of what you're playing with if you really want to go here.
That's loving.
And man, yeah, it was. It pressed me into him. It scared the bejesus out of me, so that I was running towards change, and not like yeah kind of okay, like playing with it. And it's so easy to play with the idea that you're forgiven for your sin and not run after holiness and run after what needs to be done in our lives. And there's just, and it, to me, that is, I can forgive, and I do. I forgive my children. And I overlook things with my children, but that never ceases me from holding the appropriate. See, like, I then draw a boundary for their growth.
The appropriate accountability.
Yeah. I want them to grow up. I want them to change for the good. And if I tried to change them from bitterness, I would destroy them. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't actually be doing them a good at all. And so forgiveness is the first move, and it must possess the desire for the change of the other. Or that forgiveness is going to be impotent. It's not birthing anything good.
I think we've confused love with acceptance as well. And so this idea of forgiveness and love means I allow you to continue to abuse me without calling things good, or calling bad things good and good things bad. If I really love someone, if I really care about them, I'm not going to let them continue to harm everyone else in the family, including themselves. That's not a loving act, to not confront someone about the bad thing that's going on in their life. It's the differences in the attitude. I want you to repent. I need to show you how severe this sin is in your life. I care deeply for you. Please don't do this thing, right? And there are consequences. It's more loving when God gives us consequences on this side of the grave than he wait till you get to the final judgment. And so it is what I call roadblocks to hell. They're literally obstacles in your way to get you to see, you know, what hell is like before you get there, so you change. There's nothing more loving than that to me, than someone saying, like, I'm going to show you, you know, the consequences so you feel that and come back to repentance. If you're like, I'm going to punish you, this is fun, then yeah, you're not forgiven. You don't have love in your heart.
And I really liked what you were saying, Stephen, too, about God will just hand you over to it. You know,
if that's God's
wrath. If it
wrath,
becomes this recurring thing, God will just hand it off. You know, just and I think in part of that is allowing you to see the depravity of that and turn back to him, hopefully. You know, or you show where your heart really is, and you just go deeper and deeper in pursuing that sin and further away from God, which I think also I've talked to couples, and I think sometimes when couples are Christians and, you know, maybe varying, you know, devotedness, you know, to their faith and to God, come into a church for counseling, marriage counseling, the church is always going to say, you guys should stay together. You guys should work this out. You guys, you know, I feel like there's been some surprises with people when I say maybe you shouldn't be together, in the sense that of this, though. I often feel like married couples feel like there's only two choices. We either stay together and work this out, or we get a divorce and we're no longer married. And I think an important tool, kind of like what you were saying with Christ just kind of handing us over, is separation. You know, a separation, you know, here we've declared the boundaries of what is acceptable and not acceptable. We have declared what the consequences is of breaking those boundaries, whether, you know, if you're relapses or another affair or whatever, you know, then the consequences are we're going to separate. And part of that, I think, too, is we're separating for the purpose of holiness and working on each ourselves and coming back together in a healthier state, and hopefully that person who is, you know, relapsing in addictions or whatever doesn't take it as a free card to go down that path. Well, now I don't have, you know, I don't have my spouse over my shoulder and, yeah, and griping at me all the time, so I can just indulge myself. Because I think, too, in that respect, kind of like you were talking about Christ, that is showing the, where your heart really is.
Well, I see
you know,
that.
You really don't want the marriage. You want that. And so I think it clarifies things, but it also gives you an opportunity to see what life is like without it. Because sometimes we don't realize or appreciate what we have until we might not have it, you know. And then it basically really stirs our heart to go, no, this is really what I want.
I think that I want to just say that one of the important things for the addict is to realize that this is your problem, married or not. Like, you get separated, and it's not the separation that should have shown you that. This is your relationship with God that you're dealing with. And if you're unwilling to change, if you're only trying to change because you're in a marriage.
Mm-hmm. Well, you want something?
Who's God?
Right. Yeah, marriage. And what you want.
Yeah.
You.
And so,
and if you're thinking, ooh, if we get separated for a while, I could really, then you're.
Well, you think God's not going to punish you.
You've really defined where your heart's at.
Do you really believe in God? I see this when people get divorced. I've seen them. One person, even if it's the person who did the wrong thing, one person runs to the church. The other one runs to the thing that they always wanted to do, which is permission. And they didn't have permission to do that while they're married. So now they do, and they don't need anyone telling them what to do. If your first inclination is, now I'm free to do whatever I want, I'm going to do it, then you know that in the relationship, your idol was your own need or desires over the other person.
So here's an interesting group of people that fit our kind of conversation. Jesus is speaking through John to the churches in the book of Revelation. And he hits Laodicea. And we, if you know your Bible, you know this is that lukewarm church. And he's like, listen, the Amen, the faithful true witness, the beginning of God's creation. He says, I know your works. You're neither hot nor cold. What that you are either cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I'm going to spew you out of my mouth. For you say I'm rich and I've prospered, need nothing. So you got all that grace. You got everything. You're all good. But you're wretched, pitiable, poor, blind, naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined by the fire that you may really be rich. White garments so you may clothe yourself and cover the shame of your nakedness wouldn't be seen. And the salve anoint your eyes. And then he says this. You'd think, oh my gosh, he's so stern and so mean to these people, telling them they're... He says, those whom I love, I reprove and discipline. So be zealous and repent. Let me say, this is Jesus talking. Those whom I love, he accepts and invites... he will reprove and discipline. So be zealous and repent. And this is how we image it. When you're forgiving... But, you know, those who we love, we're going to reprove, we're going to confront, and we're going to allow our consequences. And this is Jesus's words right there. And so, and he's asking a church to come, and he's willing to receive them. And so that to me is, if we're going to have that verse in this coming next week, but I think a lot of people need to memorize that one because it's such a good corrective to this. We just accept. No. True love reproves and disciplines
accepting
for their betterment.
Accepting a true repentant person is going to want to accept and take ownership of the responsibility of their contribution to it. That's why I do like when you started the sermon series, you said you got to start with hating your own sins. Mm-hmm. If the first thing you think about is, well, you did this and you did that and you're the reason, right off the top, you're not repentant. You're more concerned about covering yourself up and covering your sins up. And so it is good that both parties actually sit and go, let's do some self-examination of what I've contributed to make this where it's at. And I think that's healthy. But it's just so interesting that we follow the model of Genesis. Like, I want to cover my sins and I don't want anyone to see them in my family. And so these are good roadblocks to tell you where your heart is. And they're very clear in scripture, these models. And I think they're important to examine. So,
All right. So we got a couple of questions. And one of the questions kind of really does hit on the whole, we got some questions. I wonder what they say. All right. So we did get a question. Was it your sister that asked this question about God forgiving?
God
forgetting?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, that was my sister.
All right. So this goes out to Cinnamon, but the question is, if God forgives and forgets, then how can he recall them again at judgment time for us? Because, I mean, we are going to be judged and others are going to be judged. And, you know, we will stand accountable for everything we did, good or bad. But if God has forgiven us and he forgets our sin, because he forgets it, you know, then how can he bring it back up again at judgment time?
So, couple notes here. This is coming from a couple passages in scripture. So we've got Isaiah 43 verse 25, and Yahweh is speaking here. And I believe the context is just this. It's basically, he's speaking to Israel and he's trying to call them back. So he says, yet you didn't, he's like, I've called for you guys. You didn't call upon me, O Jacob, but you've been weary of me, O Israel. You've not brought me sheep for burnt offerings or honored me with your sacrifices. And so he lays out all their stuff. You've not brought me sweet cane with money or satisfied me with the fat of your sacrifices. Even though they were doing these things, he's like, look, your heart wasn't with me, but you have burdened me with your sins and you have wearied me with your iniquities. So he says, I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake, and I will not remember your sins. Put me in remembrance. So then, first of all, we need to put it in context, because this is a declaration of what kind of God he is. He is the kind of God who will blot out your transgressions for his own sake and not remember your sins anymore. It's not saying that he has done that yet in the text, in Isaiah. In Isaiah, he is saying, this is who I am. I am he who blots out your transgressions. So remember me. Stop sinning. Know that I'll wipe them clean. Come back to me. I'm the one who loves you. I'm the one who cares about you. I'm the one who will reprove you, and you know, that whole thing. And so that's the first one. The second one that shows up is in Jeremiah, and it's in Jeremiah chapter 31. And this is actually the section that we get the new covenant language from. Jeremiah 31:31 begins, "Behold, the days are coming, declares Yahweh, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. Not like the covenant that I made with my fathers on the day in which I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, my covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, declares Yahweh. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, declares Yahweh, I will put my law within them. I will write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And no longer shall each one teach his neighbor and his brother, saying, know Yahweh, for they shall all know me. From the least of them to the greatest, declares Yahweh, for I will forgive their sin, iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more." This is a future tense. And so what we have here is a future orientation to in which there is a day in which we will all know the Lord, that we'll be walking. This is a picture of the fullness of the of eternity. Like when we've all resurrected, everything's, we're not going to need to walk around saying, know the Lord. We're all going to know him from the least to the greatest. And he's forgiven our iniquity at that time. And yes, he will not have remembered our sins anymore. So this is a future oriented piece, not a present oriented reality. At our time now, he's overlooked our sins. There is a day in which we will stand before the Bema seat. Paul talks about this in 1 Corinthians, in which he's going to test our works. He's going to look over these things. And I do think that there is a point at which we will know we are saved. And so, because he's declared us forgiven, that it's been paid for. That means in that time, I believe he blots out our sins fully and completely. I think that's what Christ has done for us. He's paid for it. And that'll be a day of declaration, which it's clear that that's been done. So I don't see this as like a contradiction in situation where right now he's forgiven your sins, so he forgot. He's saying, I'm the kind of God who's going to blot it out and clean it out and remove it. And I'm never going to remember it again. I'm not going to bring it up anymore. So he's not going to, just as us as love doesn't hold a record of wrongs. You know, that's the idea. Once you've forgiven, one of the key pieces is that you're not going to just keep bringing it back up. It's reframed in the sense that it's integrated into your story, into your life. You could remember it and bring it up, but it's not going to be for the same purpose of judgment or things like that. Go ahead, Stu.
Well, I just think that also people confuse this with the omniscience of God or all knowing, you know, and we're confusing the two. We're talking about very specific ideas of the law, right? So usually you would go before a king and the law that would be broken could be read out or said something. There'd be a record of it in a book, and that was held against you as a charge. And God's saying, I'm going to erase that charge. It doesn't mean he didn't. I don't remember anything.
Then they didn't have erasers.
When you get a pardon, it's as if it never happened.
You blot it out. You know what I mean? You cross it off the offense list. And so the idea.
That's what you do when you're in high school and you're writing and you'd have to scratch it over with your ink to make it disappear.
Yeah, you want to make sure no one knows it. So you put like little circles and squigglies.
That's blotting.
Yeah. And so the idea here, don't lose sight of the idea here, is this record that's held against your account that he's going to blot out. And the idea is that he's not like, oh, God just doesn't know. You ask him, hey, did I ever sin? What are you talking about? Like, I don't know what's going on. That's not what's the metaphor is that there is a literal sin that you did that literally is held to you being, you know, deserving of hell. You ask for forgiveness. God's not going to, when it comes to the record books, the record book is let out. Yep, that's what the record was. Oh, I'm going to cross that off. It's no longer held against. Christ paid for that.
Right.
He took that offense, so I'm crossing it off my list. You're no longer held accountable. There's no record of it anymore.
In the omniscience of God section, when we talk about that attribute, yeah, and this is brought up, we can also talk about the idea that when we use the word, when the word remembered is used in the scriptures, the first time that shows up is with Noah. So Noah's on this boat. It's been almost a year now of stuff going on. And it says, but God remembered Noah and all the beasts and the livestock there were in with him in the ark. And then he starts to act to bring the waters down. And the picture isn't like he's up there going like, oh, I'm just having a great day. You know, I flooded the earth and everything. Oh no, I forgot Noah. You know, it's like,
no. Oh, Noah.
Oh, Noah. That's a groaner. And it's the idea that he brings them into the forefront
of his recollection.
Of his focus, yeah. Like in the sense that he is bringing him before, he's going to bring before him his covenant. He's going to and so when you see the idea of remembered, it's as if, it's not like memory in the sense it's
not remembering and forgetting.
It's intention. Focusing. Yeah. It's a focused intention. And so he's saying, I'm never going to have a focused intention on your sin ever again.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean it's not somewhere like in his knowledge.
He doesn't know it ever happened.
and I will say it is kind of like the, you know, what you were talking about, you know, the last couple of podcasts or whatever, and you were talking about the already, but not yet, you know? And I remember you saying something that like, 20 years ago, and you were talking about like, when are you saved? You know, were you saved and forgiven of your sin at the cross? Were you saved and forgiven of your sin when you received Christ? Or are you forgiven, you know, of your sin when judgment comes, you know?
Right.
And I was just kind of like, oh, and you were like, well, all three, you know? And it's kind of like the idea of, are you a millionaire when somebody, you know, writes out a check for you for $1 million, you know, that's good check. Because if I did it, you're not a millionaire, just to tell you. But, you know, are you a millionaire when somebody writes out that check to you? Are you a millionaire when somebody hands you the check? Or are you a millionaire when you cash the check?
Or when you spend it.
Huh?
Or when you spend
it. Yeah, you know, and it's kind of like, all three, you know, you're a millionaire. As soon as that check is written, you have possession of it when you receive it, but you experience it when you deposit it, mm-hmm. you know? And I think it's kind of that same thing here. You know, we're forgiven of our sin, but we are also going to be forgiven of our sin.
Right. That's a great illustration because there's a sense that
it's your illustration.
Right. I mean, well, not the check part. The check part's an adjustment that you've made, and I like that because there's also a sense that you could be promised. Like, so the Old Testament people are promised a check is going to be written. And so they trusted that promise waiting for that check. Then Christ comes and writes the check. And so they receive the check. They're going to receive it immediately. Like, they get they've already, you know, they've built all this credit, and they lived a life of credit. They lived a life where they were taking it on credit, and Jesus shows up and goes, okay, paid. So they experienced all of that, and now we get the check. We live our life in the knowledge of what's coming when we put it in. So we live on credit as well. Mm-hmm. And so sometimes we live on that credit. That already portion is to think of it as like, he shows up and heals, or he shows up and he works a miracle, or he shows up and does something in an answered prayer. Well, that's based on the promised credit that's coming to us. It's not fully here yet, but it's guaranteed in the sense that I'm holding the check. And so what's powerful is to think of those terms of like, I'm forgiven. Now, that doesn't mean I'm going to run out there and go sin like crazy. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm not going to act like I'm not appreciative to the person who gave me the check, but I am living in such a way that I can fully and completely feel free and do what I need to do and know that when I deposit this thing, all those bills are going to be paid. So it's kind of that interesting kind of gives
already
you that
and
sense.
Not yet is a very hard concept for some people, for just any of us to understand, because in some sense you have it, and in some sense it's not complete until you stand before the Lord and you are now in the new Jerusalem,
in the new body,
in the new body. Yeah, because there was like you were promised eternity. We're not really experiencing that. We're all going to die. So,
all right, and so we've got one more question. Mm-hmm. We probably spent a little bit of time on this. So Shatera, yes, you did get your question in time for the podcast. So she says, greetings.
Greetings.
While I recognize Catholic and some Protestant denominations perform infant baptisms.
Oh boy.
I grew up in a Baptist church where baptism took place after confessing your sin and professing a personal faith in Christ and his atoning work on the cross. I've been studying some scriptural support as to why Catholics perform infant baptisms and came across a video from Mike Schmitz using Mark 2 to support the idea that our sins, an infant's original sin, can be forgiven through someone else's faith. In this case, the parents and the godparents who are having the child baptized. We see through the Gospels Jesus healing people left and right, and we see terms like your faith has healed you, Mark 5:32. Your faith has made you well, Matthew 9:22. When he heals the blind man in Matthew 9:29 and 30, he says, because of your faith, it will happen. Then their eyes were opened. Rise and go. Your faith has healed you. Luke 17:19, receive your sight. Your faith has healed you. However, in Mark 2 and Matthew 8, we see through the faith of someone else's forgiveness and healing took place. His healings are clearly physical, but how can we determine which are both physical and spiritual healings salvific? Did the faith of the four men who lowered the paralyzed man through the roof bring about forgiveness for his sins? I happen to think when Jesus saw their faith, he saw all their faith, not just for the four men, but I could be wrong. Would love to hear your thoughts. It looks like you thought through this pretty well, though. Also, with infant baptism being unbiblical, should someone who has strong convictions about this not attend for the sake of the relationship? So I'll just start right there. Number one, infant baptism being unbiblical. Do you guys believe that it's unbiblical, or it's just not really mentioned in the Bible?
That would be unbiblical also, but in a different way. If it's not mentioned in the Bible, you'd have to equate it to the Bible. The thing
well,
is
when I think of unbiblical, yeah. I mean you are going against, you know, the faith, you know.
So is it counter to scripture? I don't particularly care for church practices that we've created and take strong stances are that aren't explicitly mentioned somewhere in the scriptures. There's nowhere in the Bible where it explicitly says baptize your infants. And so this idea that just because the early church did it in 300, 350 or whatever, that somehow this is a church practice that we should adopt is something that you kind of have to create. You know, and so the question is it a salvific issue? It can be, depending on what you think is happening to the infant, right? But it becomes an added thing that you're adding to the church practice that you have to kind of
clarify what you mean by a salvific issue.
So if by the dunking of just water, one obtains salvation, does that not change the way in which God says that we are to be saved? You confess with your mouth, believe in your heart the Lord is God, then you are saved.
Babies, so you're not saying, you're not saying,
babies, but they can't make that
confession. You're not saying that if somebody believes in infant baptism, that they're not saved.
No, I'm saying that if you believe the baby is saved because they got dunked in water, that isn't indicated anywhere in Scripture. And to assume that they are because of that act is adding an act to salvation that I don't see to be clear in Scripture. And you're going to have to do a lot of explaining as to how that relates to God telling you. You have to confess with your mouth and believe in your heart. And then every time baptism is usually mentioned in the Acts, it usually follows someone making a confession and going, why don't I get baptized, right? And so that is usually the procedure that we follow. It's the confession that leads to the baptism.
In fact, it's the confessions that led to the creeds.
Yeah.
And the creeds that we have today are called, are the creeds you would say when you converted to become
a Christian.
A Christian. And so this is a difficult issue in the sense that do I think that people who hold to infant baptism can be saved? Absolutely.
Sure.
I don't think that this is a salvific matter in the sense that those who hold it, whether it tells you whether they're saved or not. However, it is a salvific matter if somebody is running around saying, well, I'm saved because I got baptized.
Yeah.
But they're living in sin and they're living
in
all kinds
of things.
Well,
they never made a confession.
And even, and I'll just be honest, even a Catholic wouldn't say that they're saved at that point because of the difference in, there's a conflation going on here. And this is why it feels confusing. The Catholic vision of justification is different than the Protestant vision of justification. The way the Protestants understand justification is that when you receive Christ, he has forgiven you of your penalties and of all your sins, and you are now justified. The idea is that he's made you right, and that, mm-hmm. that would be the right. Your relationship has been made right with God.
Restored.
All the legal penalty is paid. You're justified to live like you're going to heaven. You're right with God. And so that means from that point, it's sealed, you're done, you grow in sanctification based on a worship of your, you know, you worship God. And so sanctification is about a response to your salvation. The Catholic has an inverted view of that. They would view that justification is an infusion of Christ's righteousness as a separate substance in heaven that is coming and infusing you. It's his good works. It's his entire like ability to. It's like a substance almost. It's easier to understand if you think of it like you're being filled with this substance, and now you have to live that out. Like you're, and that's what sanctification is. And the more you do that, the more you're ridding yourself of the sins of this world, and you're not gonna have to do that in purgatory. You're being transformed, and so saints do it fully, and in fact can add to it, and they end up in heaven. And this is one version of Catholic theology. There's a bunch of versions of Catholic theology. But the idea that an infant then, after Augustine came around, and he said that, look, no, everyone is born fully and completely in sin in the sense that you're condemnable. Like, you are condemned in Adam's sin. That when that happens, and many Presbyterians will hold to this, and Lutherans will still hold to this, and they do infant baptism. And they will all argue that, no, a child is condemned in Adam's sin, and therefore the Presbyterians will say it's the belief of the family that saves a child if they die when they're babies. The Catholics are saying a baptism saves the child when they're babies. And so this is to keep them from falling into, if a child dies apart from baptism, they go to limbo.
Oh, yeah.
They don't actually go to hell. They go to limbo. And limbo is this amorphous state in which you are neither condemned nor alive. And then there's questions about what happens to people in limbo. But
limbo is different than purgatory.
Yeah, and it has nothing to do with a bar.
Yeah, like the limbo stick.
Limbo. No. So anyway,
different places, again, not mentioned in the Bible, limbo.
Yeah, these are theological constructs.
You start digging these constructs out.
That are created to answer conundrums that are created by the way they understood how salvation worked. So when it comes to those who are Protestants and believe in baptism, in the sense of like child baptism, infant baptism.
There are a lot of churches that do.
They hold that it's connected to, as an Old Testament imagery of Stephen's favorite topic.
Circumcision.
And that comes from
like New Testament circumcision.
Yeah.
And people might think that because every time circumcision comes up, Greg makes him preach.
Yeah.
So I'm going to have Stephen read Colossians chapter 2 here. Yeah. This is one of those sections that they'll bring up, Colossians chapter 2. In him also you were circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, by putting off the body of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ, having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through faith in the powerful working of God who raised him from the dead. That's a very complicated sentence. But there is a semi-equation between being circumcised. So that, I'll walk this through. In him also you were circumcised with a circumcision made without hands. So he's talking about the circumcision of the heart. Mm. The idea that you have been, because women can't be circumcised. Reminder. Circumcision, the Old Testament was only for men. There's no such thing for circumcision for women. Baptism is for all. There is no limitation. And so that's an incongruity.
Yeah, they're not similar in that sense. Also, they're not based on nation status like it would have been. Like even your household and people in your household would have to be circumcised.
So in one sense, he's saying you have been brought into the family of the Jewish king through putting off the body of flesh by the circumcision of Christ, meaning that Christ's crucifixion, his work, sets us free. I may even be referencing Christ's circumcision. I don't know. This is a very odd section of scripture in a very difficult book. But he goes on, having been buried with him in baptism. Now we're identifying a different symbol. Well, how did I put off my body in the flesh? Well, you did it when you were baptized. Okay, cool. So there's a connection between circumcision and baptism. In a sense, you become part of the community because there's a circumcision of your heart, but you're putting off the body of the flesh by having been baptized with him in baptism, okay, which you were also raised with him through what? Faith. So the integral piece here is this term faith. Like, you're raised with him through the trust. The life comes through the trust. All this other stuff is symbolism of that faith that you're going to be raised with. And this is the point that John Piper actually makes in arguing with R.C. Sproul and others who bring this up. He goes, you're ignoring that it's through faith in the powerful working of God who raised him from the dead that you have all these symbols going on.
Faith comes through the confession.
Right. Faith is first. Baptism, circumcision, all that imagery comes second. So I have no problem with them being connected. I have a problem that you say that can happen before faith. So let's go to the Mark 2 passage, which is what he's pulling on. So this is a passage in which, you know, he's returned to Capernaum. Jesus has returned to Capernaum after several days, reported that he was home, and many were gathered there together so that there was no more room, not even at the door. And he, Jesus, was preaching the word to them, and they came, it's very vague. They came bringing to him a paralytic carried by four men. So the crowd came bring a paralytic with four men. So is it the crowd that has faith? Is it four men? Is the guy, all of it? So, and when they could not get near him,
the paralytic.
When they could not get near him because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him. And when they had made an opening, they let down the bed on which the paralytic lay. And when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, son, your sins are forgiven. Now, the division seems to, that they're bringing up is, look, all these theys point to the men who dropped him down. And then he talks to the paralytic. It's not clear, actually, who the they are, because it could be the crowd. It could be the four guys. It could be all of them. And I have a tendency to kind of believe it kind of like all of them. It's this kind of community expectation that he's going to do something, which fits the text. They have all this expectation he's going to do something. And then Jesus does something out of the blue on purpose. Everybody, he sees all their faith. He sees them all that he's ready. And he goes, son, your sins are forgiven. I believe Jesus does it because he wants to do it. And he grants this man forgiveness because he's going to prove a point. And now some of the scribes are sitting there and they're questioning their hearts. Why does this man speak like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone? So notice now that
we're not talking about something else other than faith.
We're not talking about baptism. We're not talking about he's saved. They're literally going like, why is Jesus saying this?
Well, and who is he to say that?
And then he goes, okay. And immediately Jesus, perceiving in the spirit that they were questioning within themselves, he said, why do you question these things in your hearts? Which is easier to say to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven, or to say, rise and take your bed and walk? So he's now created a contest. He's saying, you know, obviously it's easier
words,
to say
words
are easy. You know, it was true, but that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, I say to you, rise, pick up your bed and go home. And he rose and immediately picked up his bed and went out from before them all, and they were amazed and glorified, saying, and they were all amazed and glorified, saying, we've never seen anything like this. That they had the faith to see him what? Heal. So he says, I forgive your sins. I don't think that this
and
has...
And he probably said, I forgive your sins, to bring up the tension so that he can perform a miracle.
And I believe his point is, which do you think is the greater miracle? Yeah. That this man is getting up and walking away? Or that I can forgive his sins? Who do you think that I am? This is the question that he's asking. I don't think it has anything to do with, oh, they had the faith, and therefore a group faith can cause somebody else to be saved. No, the context of the text is this intense competition of who the identity of Jesus is as the one who can forgive sins.
Kind of the same, along the same lines as Jesus could have died on the cross saying, I forgive you, I'm doing this to forgive everybody of their sin, and then that was it. But raising from the dead brought the power to the words that he was saying.
Right. You know? And I think that what we're seeing here is a a misconstrual of the argument of the text, where he's fixated, where this man is fixated on the they had faith, and so he says the sentence. I think that the point of the text is that they had faith, and so when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven." I don't think the sons, your sins are forgiven, are necessarily have to be related to him seeing their faith. He saw, well, obviously they had faith. They're bringing a paralytic, digging it through the wall, dropping him down. They really think he can heal him. That's what they have faith in. And Jesus plays this game because he wants to prove, I have the power to do a greater miracle.
I don't know.
Jesus forgives the sins, not the faith of the people. And that's the trick. If he thinks that the faith of the people bringing a child to be baptized can forgive them their sins, he's put the atonement in the wrong location. The atonement is in the work of Jesus and your trust of him, not in the baptism, not in your faith of faith. And again, we can get into this trick. I trust that I have faith in Jesus. And so when I start doubting, I go, oh no, I don't have enough faith. It's not about your faith. It's about Jesus. Jesus saves, not your faith in Jesus that saves you. Like, don't have faith in your faith. Have faith that Christ can save. Trust that he saves you. Trust his promise. Don't trust whether you trust his promise. He can do it. All right. Sorry.
The strength of the miracle isn't in your faith. It's in the one you have the faith in. You know? Did you have something?
I just wanted to ask a question. What do you think they were going there expecting, and why do you think they were going there to expect? They had faith that he would heal them, and that's all they had faith in, or did they think he was the Messiah?
I think that they had faith that he would heal them.
Okay.
I think this is obviously set up to where this is, I mean, look at the fixation on the fact that there's all these people, the doors closed up, he was preaching the word to them, right? So, and they came bringing him a paralytic. Okay, there's once, carried by four men. When they could not get near him because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him and an opening let down on which the paralytic lay. Why don't they just say, let the man down? I mean, he's emphasizing the paralytic. He's emphasizing the works that they did to get the paralytic in front of them. And Jesus sees this as faith, faithfulness, fidelity, trust. They really trust that he can do this.
They trust that God can heal?
Yeah, because he's already done it.
Yeah.
And then he flips it on him. Your son, your sins are forgiven. I don't think you have to associate the two things. I think he's setting something up on purpose to prove a point. What do you think the greater miracle is? Who do you think, what do you think really say? And we get it all wrong. Who's the one who forgives the sins? Jesus says that you may know the Son of Man has been given the authority to forgive sins. Not because of your faith, not because of their faith, not because of it. No, he has the authority to do so. And so
he's trying to make a point as to how important it is to focus on who this forgiver of sins is.
Right.
Yeah.
So, I mean, a couple of things. Did you guys watch the video?
No, I'm just going off of what you told
so
us.
So a couple of the points that he made in the video was about baptisms. He does say that they believe baptisms save us, right?
Right.
So, I mean, that's not...
It's a sacrament,
We know that. It's a sacrament. So, and I think, because what he was saying too, he was saying Peter says that baptisms save us.
Yeah, that's actually in 1 Peter 3:21.
You know, so speak on that. You know, he's talking about Christ suffering for righteousness, that he may bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh. You know, because they formerly did not obey when God's patience waited in the days of Noah while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is, eight persons, were brought safely through the water. Baptism, which corresponds to this, now saves you, not as a removal of dirt, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So he's comparing Noah's journey in the water to baptism. So just as that saved him, baptism saves us. Right?
Right.
I mean, that's what his position is. So, I mean, one of the things I think that gets contradicted in what he was saying on the video was he was saying non-Catholic Christians believe that baptism really is a symbolic confirmation of what, basically of your faith, right? Mm-hmm. Where he's saying, no, baptism saves us. But when he's comparing baptism to Noah's Ark, I mean, that is symbolic, right? I mean, it's, so to me, it's kind of like he's saying, it's not symbolic. but it is symbolic, you know?
Right.
So I felt like there was a contradiction there. And one of the other things he said, and I'll let you guys speak on both of those, which you think, but one of the things that he said that I thought was interesting, not that I agreed with it, but he was talking about infant baptism. He said it needs, it's necessary as well, but he also said that it's a grace, you know, it's a grace. And part of that is other people's faith, forgiveness of sins, baptism, that kind of stuff. But what he said is, you know, if I profess my faith in Christ and I get baptized, he says, not everybody, but some people look at their baptism with this, you know, ooh, look what I did, you know? And so it's more of a work of righteousness, where infant baptism is definitely a grace because you had no choice in the matter. It was a grace that was bestowed upon you. So you have nothing to brag about or take credit for.
Okay, cool. I mean, it's a grace in the sense that I think, again, from what I understand of Catholic theology, and again, I'm not a Catholic theologian, so that graces are things that are bestowed.
But I play one on a podcast.
Yeah, exactly. I know. As far as I understand, then the sacraments are bestowals of grace from heaven, which are infusions of God's grace. And again, it's this kind of like mercy and love and righteousness. It's stored and it comes down. It's kind of compartmentalized away from us and it has to be bestowed and given. This is a very Augustinian concept. Go ahead.
No, I just you finish with your thought because mine's going to go in a slightly
different. Just so that there I understand what he's saying in his context that like it is a grace in the sense that he didn't ask for it, they didn't do it.
It wasn't a work.
It came down, and so but it's God giving that grace because of the action of the parents, and so it is a grace in that sense. But is that really what it's getting at in baptism? No, there's no symbolism of it speaking of baptism as a grace. It is an act. It is a work that you can do, but it is not a work that you do to be saved. Anyway, I'll get to that in a minute. Go ahead, Steve. What were you thinking?
No, just the idea that sometimes people, you kind of, it seems like people have a stance and then you're trying to fill in with the Bible. You know, to me, what you see as the pattern in the Bible is someone making a confession and getting baptized. You don't see someone who didn't make a confession who get baptized, infant or not, like you would with something like maybe circumcision of the Old Testament, which is why that's more of an interesting argument to be made. But the idea that like Cornelius in Acts chapter 10, he gets saved and then they go, let's baptize you. It wasn't like, well, the baptism saved you. No, he saved and then he gets baptized. So you have to explain that. The other one is, since we're not saying that the act of putting you in the water is salvific itself, then we don't have any problem with it being symbolic or not. It's not an act that engages your salvation. We're, literally, if you require it, then you are making it an act that requires salvation. Mm. So as soon as you make it a requirement to go to heaven, then you are doing something to go to heaven. And so that's a problem for most Protestants, you know, because you're adding that as a requirement.
Right. You're not saved just by faith. You're saved by faith and baptism.
And whatever other thing you have to do. But the other thing that concerns me is I don't know anyone who's been baptized, maybe you do because you've dunked more people than you guys have, that says, I'm doing this for me. Yeah. When people get baptized, they go, look what God did for me.
Right.
That is their confession. They're not saying, look, everyone, look at me. I'm earning this. Or I'm special. They're literally saying I wasn't special. God is special.
And I will say, I don't think I've ever baptized anybody with that attitude. It was the opposite attitude is the ones that I don't want to get baptized because I don't want to be the center of attention. And I'm like, trust me, you're not the center of attention.
The forgiveness of your sins by a creator God, that you're sharing your story. This is a problem, too, just with people in general. They don't want to share what God's done for them because they think they're bringing the glory to themselves.
Right.
That's more of a heart condition oftentimes. It is the profession of what Christ does in your life that brings about glory to him, not yourself.
And it's critical to remember that a lot of why this is confusing is early in the first century when you were going to profess your faith in following Jesus, you didn't walk aisles, you didn't raise hands, you didn't pray prayers. Like that didn't happen. You were gathered in a group and it came time that they were that they found out, hey, you've been with us for a while. Are you a Christian? Like, people would gather around them. They'd be associating with the community. And finally they would say, yeah, I want to follow this Jesus. And so they would say, all right, well, let's baptize you. And it was immediately, it was associated with your confession of faith, meaning that you were saying, today I am a follower of Jesus. There wasn't this sign up time and you got to wait until this week when we got a baptismal filled up and yes. They literally just like, you want to, oh, let's walk down. We're going to walk down to the river right now. We're going to baptize you right this minute because you said that you're going to make this confession of faith. And so, yes, the confession and the baptism were very closely coincided in the early church. You would make your confession and you would baptize you. And so it was that whole picture of confession where you're identifying with the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. You're literally escaping death in that moment because you're making this confession and you're making the pledge or confession with the action.
Yeah.
So they went together. They've been separated because of the debates in the church and because we've had all kinds of weird stuff happen throughout history, and we always don't have baptismals available or pools and things. And we've got an entire revivalistic history in the United States in which you walk an aisle and you sit and you go through these processes. When, to be quite honest, it would be easier if people in small groups had invited non-Christians in, talk to them, and when they're just like, you know, I really want to follow Jesus, they go, we got a spa, let's go right now. You can make your confession, and we'll baptize you right here. And that would be far closer to what would have happened.
We could go to the fountain at the crossing.
Right. And so when you look at this First Peter with that mentality in mind, you hear it this way. It says, after they were disobedient long ago, so he's, because Christ also suffered once for sin, the just for the unjust, to bring you to God. I'm reading from the NET, the New English Translation. That's a translator's version. But by being to bring you to God, by being put to death in the flesh, but by being made alive in the Spirit, in it he went and preached to the spirits in prison. After they were disobedient long ago, when God patiently waited in the days of Noah as an ark was being constructed, and an ark of few, that is, eight souls, were delivered through water. So again, the water is always a representation of death. Death and chaos, destruction, and the
brings
end.
Brings you through the death.
And so, and this prefigured baptism, which now saves you. Clarification, not the washing off of physical dirt, but the pledge of a good conscience to God through the resurrection of Jesus Christ.
Pledge in your profession.
It was literally the profession, the pledging, the connection of what you were saying was more important than the even act. So baptism gets connected with the picture of you being saved because it is the picture of your pledge. Mm-hmm. An infant can't make a pledge. Mm-hmm. And therefore, you can honestly say that infant can't be saved. He's not doing something from a pledge.
Can't confess.
He can't confess it.
Okay. And I know we're running late, but this brings up another interesting topic is, all right. So, when it comes to baptism, infant baptism and everything else, you were talking about the circumcision of the heart and, you know, it used to be a practice of circumcision. So when you look at the Old Testament, and I mean, I've heard, and I don't necessarily fully adhere to it, but baptism is the replacement of circumcision, you know, or the new covenant of, but in the Old Testament, huh?
That is an argument. But
so,
yeah.
But like in the Old Testament, right? I mean, if you were a follower, you know, of, you know, God, you know, for Israel, everybody was baptized, you know, I mean, not baptized. Everybody was circumcised. Abraham, and then all of your family, all of your household, all of your slaves, everybody.
Not your women.
Not your women.
and even your children were circumcised at 8 days or whatever, right? So all the males were. So again, baptism, circumcision as that marking, right? Children were circumcised in the faith. And so at 8 days, baptism, could that correlate with infant baptism in that sense? Because that is kind of the mark of faith is baptism. You know, proclamation of your faith is baptism. And so, and then there's other passages that talk about baptism and their whole household was baptized, you know. And so that is one of the arguments I've heard about infant baptism is just, see, you know, the people, the family, the children, and everybody in the house was baptized. So right there is children's baptism or infant baptism. So how do you position on that?
I argue that's more of a picture of corporate salvation than it is infant baptism, because they actually don't, there's no knowledge there was a baby. It's a, yeah, it's an argument.
Like right now in your household, how many infants are there? You know what I mean? Like that's not always the case if in a household has infants. So it's an assumption from silence. You don't know how big these households were, what they were talking about. So it's like, though, and we, what I think in the text is what you often see is the person going there and preaching to the household, and then all of them get baptized. Sometimes there's some other passages that are like that, but those are very vague passages that that people will make an entire doctrine based off of. So that's the harder one. The circumcision one is maybe a little harder. I'd like to hear Greg's thought on this, but before that, I would say you can't like make a one-for-one equation.
Right.
If half of the population or half women cannot be baptized, and then all of a sudden infant babies that are women or girls that are getting baptized, that's not a one-for-one. So you already have to say that baptism and circumcision are different in
yes.
some way. And so if you're adding the practice, then you're saying it's circumcision, then it would just be the men that would be baptized. And so right away, you're not practicing it like they would have. And the other thing, it had to do more with nation status and who you affiliate with, which is also a part of the promised group of people that were set apart. They weren't all saved. The nation of Israel was elect and set apart to bring about the Messiah, Jesus, through their line. But not every one of them were Yahweh followers, even when they were circumcised. So you have to keep in mind, some of these are not similar. In some ways they are, and some ways they are not.
Yeah, so I think that's critical to remember that the Old Testament image of circumcision surrounds the concept of the seed.
The promised seed to come.
It's a promised seed that's coming. That's coming through Abraham and his children and his offspring. But this is a seed promised from the woman. And so this is a very interesting situation, that there's this woman who's going to come, there's this seed born, but it's through the seed of Abraham, and that's shown through a covenantal sign as passed through men to ultimately a girl who is going to bring about the seed. Now, at that point, I would say that circumcision is fulfilled. Its process to get to the seed has come.
Which is Jesus.
Which is Jesus. Jesus is the fulfillment of circumcision. And he is what the seed was aiming at and came to as Jesus is here. Now, we do not image. So that bases all the way back from Genesis chapter 1, verse 28, where it says, you know, be fruitful, multiply, fill the world, subdue it. So you have this picture of seed being important to the whole work of creation. And in that case, absolutely, it's true. And so what they are, the selected Edenic people in that sense, who are going to be about bringing about this creation. However, when you get to Jesus, now the question isn't how do I enter in? I don't enter in through birth. Jesus told us in his creation statement, in his purpose statement, go into all the nations and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey all that I've commanded you, and lo, I'll be with you at the end of the age. That is actually parallels that I have an entire book that walks through the parallels of that passage with the Genesis passage. And the reason why is because this is how you make the new nations. So the picture isn't through a seed. The picture is through death, burial, and resurrection. So it has a correlation.
But he changed.
But it's a radically new picture and has absolutely nothing to do with children. It has to do with people becoming disciples. Mm. And again, a baby isn't made a disciple. They have to assent to that following of Jesus Christ. It's a pledge. And so they didn't baptize babies. And
it would have been odd even early on for people to think that way. I don't think that's what they would have thought baptism was, especially from a Jewish perspective.
Yeah, it was a picture of a washing.
Yeah.
And I'm washing away all of my sin. I'm coming out of the graves of the grave of the death chaos waters into life.
And one of the arguments was, well, the early church did it. Well, the early church 350, you know, 350 years after Jesus was born is roughly around the time where, and the first statement of it is typically someone questioning it. So there was a lot more in the early church fathers about this discussion more than and there wasn't really a lot early on closer to Acts.
All that being said, we're defending our Baptist perspective.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
That's
no, I mean, and here's the thing: it's not something that would break away from me believing in salvation with or talking to someone who believes that you know they want to do that.
And so, Greg, to the answer, if you were to go to the baptism, if you were to go to the baptism to just honor the family. I would say look at it as a child dedication.
Yeah.
It's really what it is. It's just a more ceremonialized child dedication.
And in practice, they're still going to, hopefully, if it's a good Bible-believing church in that sense, they're going to want to talk about salvation with the child anyway. Typically, yeah. those churches
they'll take them through catechism.
And then the confirmation.
They're confirming their faith.
And although they believe it's salvific, baptism is to protect the child with the hope that they will receive Christ and confirm it at their confirmation and stuff like that. So it is partly a faith and a hope of what they will do.
And that's why I encourage people who've been baptized as babies to see that as maybe, perhaps God didn't give you a grace of that family and these things, and now you're ultimately coming to the fruition that you're saying, this is my faith, and I'm showing it with this ancient picture, and you don't have to deny your past, and no. It's actually, in some ways, you're finalizing that confirmation that I'm following Jesus on my own. So, and that's how we argue that.
But, and it's not such a heretical idea that we would not, that you should not go.
Right, no.
Support them, love them. And again, as we started out this thing talking about offended, it's okay that people have different opinions, especially when it's not a primary theological issue. So,
fun stuff. And we hope you guys enjoyed this romp around forgiveness land and a bunch of other things like that. We've had a good time with you. I hope you've had a good time with us. And so may God bless you guys. If you've got any questions, send them our way. You can send them to rabbittrail@obcc.church. Again, that's rabbittrail@obcc.church. And we'd love to hear from you. Otherwise, have a great day. Have a great rest of the week. And we'll talk to you soon. God bless.
Boom, chakalaka.
Bye.